When we see reconstructions of ancient Rome, we are quite amazed at how large the city must have appeared 1700 years ago. On these paintings here by Josef Bühlmann, which he painted in 1887 and 1888, we can see Rome at the zenith of its splendor. It must have been quite a sight to behold, and Bühlmann, in my opinion, perfectly captures the might and splendor of Rome at the zenith of its power, when the city reached its greatest extent. This was surprisingly late. In fact, Rome reached its largest extent in the early 300s AD, and Bühlmann chose the triumph of the Emperor Constantine as a backdrop for his paintings, after Constantine had defeated Maxentius at the famous Battle of the Milvian Bridge, about which we of course will talk in a separate video. Because the fate of the world was decided in this battle, and it therefore deserves a lot of analysis and will also serve as a branching point for alternate history considerations. So we are surprised to find Rome reaching the zenith of its might quite late in history, in 312 AD. It is one of these ironies of history that Rome reached its peak not so long before the decline started. In fact, we shall see that it was Constantine himself who is celebrated in this triumph like in the old traditions, who would initiate the decline and eventual downfall of the city of Rome. But in these absolutely incredible pictures, the light of Rome still shines very brightly. We can see hundreds of temples, many amphitheaters, very large imperial fora, such as the absolutely amazing Forum of Trajan, which even as late as the time of Cassiodorus in the early 6th century was still absolutely intact, still awing all visitors to the eternal city. I extensively talked about the state of the Forum Traianum and other monuments in the city of Rome in the late 5th and early 6th century in these two videos here. We can see many circuses, such as on this picture here, where Bühlmann painted the Circus Flaminius in exquisite detail. We can see the Mausoleum of Hadrian in the distance, reminding us of the sheer scale of the ancient monumental buildings of Rome, where it would take over 1,000 years to even come close to such a level of architecture and engineering after the light of Roma was extinct in the Gothic Wars. Bühlmann perfectly captures these scenes, and I included the link to these pictures in the description. We are amazed to see such a large city 1700 years ago, buildings upon buildings stretching towards the horizon. It is with great admiration that we see scholars like Josef Bühlmann with his very detailed paintings of ancient Rome, Rodolfo Lanciani with his maps about which we talked in the previous video, or Ferdinand Gregorovius with the, in my opinion, most detailed book about the urban history of Rome, giving us incredibly detailed information of ancient Rome as far back as the late 1800s. It really does seem that the scholarship of ancient Rome reached a peak during that time. Bühlmann's original painting is one continuous panorama 1.73 meters wide, where Bühlmann captured perfectly in astonishing detail what you might have seen in 312 AD, when Constantine entered the city and was celebrated like Sol Invictus himself. It was customary for Roman triumph to lead through the most important parts of the city. The starting place was normally the Campus Martius, the part of the city where today the Pantheon still gives witness to how monumental and impressive that area must have been. This quarter lay outside the city's sacred boundary, bordering the eastern bank of the Tiber, the Pomerium. The procession entered the city through a triumphal arch, a porta triumphalis, crossed the Pomerium, where the general or emperor surrendered his command to the Senate and magistrates. It continued through the site of the Circus Flaminius, skirting the southern base of the Capitoline Hill towards the Circus Maximus. It then entered the Via Sacra to the Forum Romanum, the traditional center of Rome. Finally then, it ascended the Capitoline Hill to the temple of Jupiter Optimus Maximus. Once the sacrifice and dedications were completed, the procession and spectators dispersed to banquets, games, and other entertainments sponsored by the triumphing general or emperor. So this was a time of great festivity and spectacle, and Constantine, contrary to some depictions, still participated in this triumph as in the old days, respecting the traditional pagan rites, as he had not yet openly converted to Christianity. We can on this picture here see how the triumphal procession enters the forum area, the final part of the triumph, where Constantine would ascend the stairs to the temple of Jupiter. In the distance to the left, we can see the Colosseum, or correctly, the Amphitheatrum Flavium, as it was called back then. In the middle, we can see the Basilica of Maxentius, which, as the name indicates, had been started under Emperor Maxentius, who died in the Battle of the Milvian Bridge against Constantine. Had history gone differently, it would be Maxentius who would be celebrated in this triumph here. And then towards the right on the horizon, we see the Imperial Palace complex on the Palatine Hill. The word palace itself derives from the word palatium, the Latin word for the Palatine Hill. That is how interwoven the concept of palace had been since ancient times with that one of the seven hills of ancient Rome. In this picture here, we can see the ancient pagan rites being performed at the temple of Juno, the wife of Jupiter, which would correspond to the ancient Greek goddess of Hera. We see a poor bull being carried to be sacrificed to the goddess and the highest temple priest worshipping Juno. Juno's giant statue on the inside of the temple thrones appropriately impressive for a goddess. In the distance, we can see the mausoleum of Augustus. In another detailed portion of Bühlmann's panorama, we see the perspective as we would have seen it from the tabularium, looking towards the Circus Maximus and towards the Palatine Hill. And in this final piece here, we can then see the destination of the procession, the temple of Jupiter Capitolinus, with the theater of Marcellus towards the right in the background. It is astonishing what level of detail Bühlmann packed into this one gigantic panorama of ancient Rome in 312 AD, down to individual characters with their clothing. Here in this portion with the Forum of Trajan, we see the baths of Constantine under construction in the background. In the foreground, we see the huge and incredibly impressive forum complex of Trajan. And in the lower right corner, we see individual soldiers cheering and telling tales of the battle at the Milvian Bridge. In the final section with the Temple of Jupiter, we can see trumpeteers intone a fanfare as the emperor himself ascends the stairs towards Jupiter Capitolinus, holding the scepter in his left hand upwards like any victor should, being cheered by the population and being greeted by the temple priests. It must have been an incredible spectacle. After this triumph here, we would have witnessed such triumphs less and less performed in Rome, as Constantine later decided to create a new capital of the Roman Empire in the East. The last triumph of that sort with an emperor would be held in early 404 AD to honor the Emperor Honorius and his general Flavius Stilicho, who previously had defeated the Visigoths under Alaric at the battles of Pollentia and Verona. However, in 404, the ancient rites would not be performed at the Temple of Jupiter, since by that time the Romans had turned away from their old traditions and Theodosius had banished all pagan rites in 395 AD. In 404, as in 312, again the poor people of Rome did not suspect what would happen later. Had they suspected it, I am pretty sure that Honorius would not have received a triumph. Later, we could see celebratory professions similar to triumphs, but not anymore on such a grandiose scale. For example, when Theuderic visited Rome in 500 AD, or when his son-in-law Eutharic celebrated his consulship in 519 AD. We would then have seen professions of a much less grandiose form, and they would not end at the temple of Jupiter Capitolinus as they would have in the old times. It is the irony of history that this emperor here, who would receive this incredibly splendorous triumph, would be the one who would cause the eventual abolishment of the old pagan rites. But that, my friends, of Roman history is a story for another time. Thank you for watching this video. I hope you are as amazed as I am by the utter level of detail which Josef Bühlmann put into his painting. The legacy of this man and his incredible painting must be preserved and shared. I say farewell, dear amici imperii Romani, and bene vale.